All right, so has the internet or online resources increased participation? Do you think people participate in class more than they would?
No. I have been really surprised to see how reticent students are to try new things online. I mean, and reticence is the nice word. Some of them are outwardly, oppositional. In one of my classes, in my History of Spain class, well, I always have somebody, no matter what the project is, who just, I'm not going to do it because it's online. So in modern Latin America, we could create a news blog, and everybody has to contribute to it, and everybody has to respond to it every week, something talking about what's going on in Latin America today. And I always have at least one person who won't do even that, right? And the more complicated things, like in History of Spain, where they're supposed to build their own interdisciplinary website, actually a quarter of my students the last time refused to do it.
Wow. It's like flat out. We're not doing it.
Just not going to do it. We set them up with the UMW blogs, yeah. And we had people from DTLT come and help, and they had all constant access to everything. And a quarter of the students refused to do it. That's how high their level of discomfort was with the technology, right?
Yeah.
Even though there was every opportunity to get comfortable with it. So that's been a tough thing to fight against. Like in a class like yours, everybody's in it because they want to be a part of the technology. But in a regular class, not everybody does. And I've found it personally challenging to bring people around to that. You know, the first day when I told my History of Spain students that they were going to do an interdisciplinary website, I had a girl drop that day. She said, I absolutely will not do it. And what do you do? You go, okay. and I think you probably also know these people. And that particularly, I think, because they're history students, they feel like that's more than they bargained for. You know, just make me read a book and talk about a book. So that's something that I still have a hard time grappling with. In modern Latin America, at least when they do the news blog, which has turned out really great in some years, and as time goes on, people get more into it.
So what technologies do you use in class? Like Canvas, obviously.
Canvas, definitely. I mean, of course, I did Domain of One's Own with my most recent 298 class with varying degrees of success. I did WordPress sites with History of Spain. Modern Latin America has a WordPress site. I've done blogs in some other site with some other classes, but never consistently.
Do you think these help with the content teaching? Not necessarily the kids participating, obviously. You're not going to do it. They're not going to learn anything. Yeah. But for the kids who do it, do you find it?
See, I think it's more important and I tell my classes this, you're not going to leave here and go, God, I'm so glad I learned about 16th century Spain, right? It's like not going to change your life most of the time. But I can give you skills that can be useful in other parts of your life and certainly in your future. And for me, I'm eager to do that kind of skill development alongside the content stuff because when you're an early modernist, I feel compelled to bring some real clear relevance to what's happening. It's cool that you're interested in it, but when push comes to shove and you graduate, people are not going to go, well, what have you learned about 17th century Spain, you know? But people are going to go, what kind of skills do you have? And if I can help augment that. But, you know, the other thing that I have done is more and more of my thesis students are using online sources to write their thesis. Almost every semester now I have somebody using all of the court cases of the London Central Court, of the Old Bailey, are online and searchable and queryable, and you can create graphs. And I've had students use that almost every semester. Somebody has wanted to do some kind of England topic, and we've done that. I've also had students, just last spring, a student build a database out of a printed source, so, and manipulate that.
So going off of that, do you think that the ability for us as students to easily pull up these things helps in our research, like as a professor grading these, are they getting better, I guess? Or have you seen a shift, maybe, is my question.
I'm not sure that I've seen any kind of a particular shift. It means access is different, you know?
Yeah.
Before I would never, you know, again, also, because I've got these constraints about language and translation, I mean, otherwise, everybody was kind of using the same books over and over again to write their theses. But this way, you know, I can have people working with court cases and things that because I generally in my own work with archival sources, things that are more familiar to me than this world of kind of novels and correspondence and stuff that's just not necessarily my specialty. So in that sense, I've been able to transform the kinds of projects that they do. But I wouldn't say that, you know, some people do well and some people not so much, and some people give it a shot and it's not doesn't work for them. I can tell you where I have seen a little more definitely creativity is in my women and gender studies majors, who we encourage to do big interdisciplinary projects for their senior capstone. We had a student put together a site where she took a lot of video. She did her own video production of her own artistic works. And put that together in a really interesting way. We've had at least one other student take her work, put it up on the web in an interesting interactive way. So,
you guys have any other? That's it.
Cool.
Okay.
Good?
Yes. Did I answer it right?
Yes.
Thank you.
Is this still recording?
Yeah.